The first structure we decided a great way to start the year was exploration. Simply allowing teachers to explore. We also assigned some rooms to explore as well to ensure that everybody sort of had a chance to get to see everyone else on campus, our elective teachers, different departments, different grade levels. We really wanted our teachers, number one, to get used to having other teachers in their classrooms, because that's a huge cultural shift that we needed to happen. But also to just get an idea of what's going on campus, you know.
Something that's been new this year that's been kind of closed in the past is that we've had access to other teachers' classrooms, which is great because not only do you get a chance to learn from the teachers, but you also get a chance to help people who are having issues in areas where you might be struggling.
I find that I really like the freedom of being able to go out to other classrooms and see other teachers do what they do, because it's hard. It's hard to find the time to be able to wiggle yourself out of the classroom and really see what other teachers are. Mr. Barron's room, to see how he does his social contract and how he has a rapport with the students to build the management on top of that, and those are all great things that I'm thinking, wow, I really want to try that next year. But if I never would have had the chance to go into his classroom, then I would have never really caught on to that, or it probably would have happened a lot. And I think it's so much easier to see something taking place in the classroom instead of just seeing a lecture
and,
about it.
At first you are worried that other teachers come in to judge you, but definitely after the first 2 weeks you get past the point where when they come in it's a relief. It's just another more teachers to help you.
Usually
I would go into a geography teacher, but she helps me the most with behavior management. And I think the stack system and our instructor allows us the opportunity to find who we need to go with to get the most help.
Kind of observed mostly, and I watched how she engaged the kids when they came in, and the current event topic that they were doing that day was very interesting and very relevant. And she did a great job with the presentation of it, outlining the expectations for the kids, modeling what their product should look like when they finish the task. And that was an incentive and motivation for me to try to do better.
Mentorship partners would be something that would naturally build on its own, but we also found assigning mentorship partners during stack time was extremely valuable for our struggling teachers. And definitely having that time designated in the day to mentor in a real world setting rather than just talking about teaching, but really being in there and assisting and helping and really seeing where the issues are, rather than just meeting a few times to talk
about
it.
My PLC partner here, Michael, I've come in and he's a first year teacher. He knows what he's doing. He's doing a really good job, but he doesn't have the experience of teaching math. So because he doesn't know what the speed bumps are coming ahead of him, what kids know and don't know. So he got, yesterday he got blindsided with finding greatest common factors. He did the lesson, it was well done, but the kids, I could tell that him and the kids were like, oh, this sucked. So I pulled him to the side and I'm like, you know, this is another way you could teach it. And kind of on the fly, we just changed the lesson, and he told me that he changed it for all his other periods and it went really well. So, you know, I was glad to be able to, you know, help out and just give another way of
doing allowed something. Me to not only meet some new teachers that I probably wouldn't normally have access to, but it's allowed me to help and also learn from the teachers that I've worked with. We have a first year teacher on campus who has struggled with some classroom management issues and also lesson planning. It's been a great opportunity for me to go into his classroom, talk to him about different situations, and sit down with him and actually plan out some lessons to try to help him alleviate those issues.
Thank you.
about some of the things that have come because of the STAC model as side effects. And last year I did a lot of time instructionally coaching teachers, but we could only do short meetings. I didn't want to take preps. Teachers really had to volunteer for that. With the stacked teams model, there is designated time where I can pull a teacher into the stacked room, and we have up to 70 minutes to meet, where we'll watch a video together of their teaching, and I've been doing a lot of that. Video coaching is amazing. And just really having that time to interact as a coach and a teacher has been invaluable.
Being a first-year teacher, our instructor, Mr. Mack, we actually go over in very good detail of how I can improve. And I really enjoy how, like, I'm able to ask tons of questions back with him. It's like a conversation. And I think I grow from that, especially. And so with the amount of time that we get, all those are possible.
Experience stacking into Mrs. Schneebeck's room. Even though she's a math teacher and I'm an English teacher, she just had a great energy. She had a sense of fun that she infused into stuff that could have been really boring. She told us a love story about multiplying negatives and positives that was hilarious, and her kids were so into it. They were just laughing their fool heads off.
So sad, but it's okay, right? So we said, it's okay, positive. It's okay, my friend, positive. You go back out into that world and you find someone who's gonna love you, right? Mm-hmm. Right? Go out into that world, positive. You find someone that's gonna love you. Positive goes and finds this other
thing. Physical movements that I don't do yet. I saw some of that with Mr. Ibarra, and I tried a bit of it with mirror on and doing the mirroring stuff.
Let's practice mirroring. Okay, mirror on.
Mirror on.
Okay. So the eight steps. A process to solve a problem. You don't repeat. Just mimic. Okay, first step. You read the entire problem. Second step. Read each sentence one at a time.
Well, it was a great experience to get to share with other teachers what I do in my classroom. It made me rethink a lot of the stuff that I did, and to make sure that, you know, my peers wouldn't come in and go like, well, what is he doing? It's, you know, is even good, a good teacher. So it really made me push myself to, you know, be a better teacher. And, you know, just getting some nods, you know, I was really, I felt a lot of affirmations as I was going along, you know, seeing some smiles, seeing some nods. It was really fun.
I also saw it with Ms. Schneebeck, and she took it to the math level, they're both math, but she took it to this level where we got up, and it was almost like doing calisthenics, and we were imitating different shapes, geometrical shapes.
90-degree angles. What's another name for this 90-degree angle? Yes, a right angle. All right, rotate those right triangles. Beautiful. Let's rotate them back. And one more time, and then we gotta make our obtuse angles. Everyone make an obtuse angle. Acute angle, look at those acute angles. Obtuse angles, obtuse angles. Obtuse angles, obtuse angles. Oh my gosh, you guys are so acute right now. Obtuse angles, acute angles.
So I need to try that on the English side and see what I can do.
And I'll have to say, it was really when I saw in Mr. Ibarra's classroom for the first time all those teachers practically in their learning, and all the students, you know, feeling the presence of all their teachers and being a part of that lesson, that it was a feeling of family that you can't manufacture. It was then I think that I realized that this is something more than just a couple of concepts. This is something that is transformational. One thing thing that we learned by doing this, the stack teams model, was that not all participations are equal. Sometimes you go into a classroom and there's very little value you can add to that class as a teacher. And so we found early on that exploration didn't necessarily bring value, even though there was a lot of learning going on. So we decided, why not just make a model, make something during stack time that's called a value-added partner, where teachers find who they feel the classroom they can go into where they add the most value. And that's actually turned out to be one of the most favorite things for our teachers to do, because they feel very comfortable because they're going into a classroom of someone that's usually a friend of theirs that they know really well, and they feel comfortable. If they feel like there's something wrong with the lesson, they'll whisper in their ear something. Or sometimes they'll take over part of a lesson if they feel like they can explain it better. And because they're partners, they're bringing value to each other. It works out really well, and they don't feel uncomfortable.
Experience when my value-added partner was in my classroom. I was having a difficult student during my lesson, so he was being disruptive, like all the students were being off task. Luckily, my value-added partner was in the class. And since she didn't know the student very well, I asked her if she could take over for the class period. And since she had done the exact same lesson, she knew what we were doing. She knew my students because she had been in there. So she took over the lesson for about 5 minutes while I talked to the student outside, called the parent. It was something that had to be taken care of immediately. And after talking to the parent, talking to the student, it hasn't been an issue then. Had my value-added partner not been here, it probably would have changed the shift of my class. It could have turned out to be something negative for the student. So luckily she was in here and the class was still able to continue on, and I was able to also talk to the student, and now the student is doing a lot better.
One of the other teachers, we've worked together a couple years, and this year we've really been able to capitalize on our relationship to create a value-added partnership. When I go into her classroom, I become another teacher in that classroom. If I have something to add to the lesson that can further student learning or impact behavior in ways that's going to improve classroom culture, I'm allowed to step in. We have that relationship where we can kind of bounce off of each other, and it's not like I'm stepping on her toes and then she comes into my classroom and it's the same way. We have this ability to understand where the lesson is going, see where maybe miscommunications are happening between the teacher and the students that normally we wouldn't have that opportunity to understand. So I really think that the value-added partnership has huge impact in the classroom. And if resources were there, I would love to have more stack periods so that we could take turns stacking all day long, because I really think it makes that much of a difference during a class period as to whether or not those students are going to achieve the goals that we're setting, the ideas that we're developing in our PLC time. I think that those value-added partners, when done effectively, can make a huge difference in student learning and classroom culture. I also love that it becomes a grade level task. So those students are also my students. They're not just Ms. Muramura's students. We work together. They know me. They say hi to me. I say hi to them. They have questions on the homework. They have questions about something that happened in class. They know that they have Ms. Muramura. They can also come ask me. So I love that part of it as well, that the students feel connected to more adults. They feel connected to the content more. They're more willing to talk about content outside of just class time because they have other people around them who they know are also interested and invested in their education.
One of my favorite structures is the support structure, where a teacher actually asks for support, or it's known that that teacher needs support. And so we assign teachers to stack into those rooms very specifically, very strategically, who we send in to support. And usually it leads to some mentorship as well, but having that extra teacher in that room to support is something that will definitely help with student learning. One of my favorite things that has naturally come about from that this year is teachers that go into support tend to pull kids out into their classrooms for small group instruction if they're that content specialist. In a particular classroom, one of our first year teachers is struggling, but we know our students still need to learn, and so the content specialist that's in there during that stack period will pull kids out, and they'll still be learning those skills in more of a small group controlled environment, and so it's really been beneficial for students and their learning when we send adults in to support in the classroom.
I often have Mr. Lozano, who has stacked that period, push in. And it's funny because there's certain times where I don't even notice that he comes in, but it's like I see this like superhero flying all over the room. And we happen to have a lot of similar, I think a lot because of scheduling, a lot of the same students. And so he's able to go, like really sort of go straight to certain students and help them either redirect them or get them on task. And there are certain periods where I leave fifth period saying, that was a much better class than normal had he not stepped in. It's a noticeable difference between a lot of other assistants I get, because he's really just coming in. He's not, you know, he's not there to observe, he's not taking notes or anything. He's just there to directly help students and to help me. And it makes a world of difference.
I feel that STAG has benefited me the most in kind of building relationships in other classrooms, not necessarily just my own. Because I get to see my students in different classrooms, different environments, and see how they react there, and it gives me a better understanding on how to teach them in my own classroom. But also, you know, establishing new relationships with different students that I wouldn't normally have interactions with on a daily basis. Next door, I help out a lot. I often try to pull out some kids in order for them to actually gain knowledge about the lesson. I pull them out of that room into my room in order for them to do small group. And even though they're getting pulled out, they're still getting the lesson. They're still being able to learn in a more controlled and quieter environment.
Directions and having someone model things out, to model as a student for other students to see, or to give directions. I felt like those were all really great things that helped me in my class, so that way when we would go out and do the activity, then everyone could kind of fall on the same page and I could be in sort of multiple places at once. I found that was really helpful, especially when I could explain to the STAC teacher that, hey, this is what we're doing, this is what we need to accomplish by the end of the period. And having a lot of that help readily accessible is very helpful.
Information to a sub for one of my PLC mates, and found out that she really just was not sure what to do, and that there was a lesson plan there, but she had a hard time following it. So I helped her. I guided the class and basically took over, taught a lesson with her as an assistant, and it worked out.
She was going on Ms. Booker's class and she needed me to back her up. So what I did was I stepped right in, I took over her kidney table activity. They were doing a shared reading, and then they were commenting on their experience in their journal, in their notebook. And I was so excited that I could actually help out in that class. It's very enriching when I walk in there, and I totally enjoy being in her class.
He has a tough crowd, seventh period, so I like to go in there and help him as much as I can with him. Letting me do pull out, he would give me kids to take out, and I would, the catch is you're trying to take not as many as you can, but you're trying to make the difference for him so he can, you know, help the other kids. So I think I took like 10. They were receptive to me. We read part of the Joy Luck Club story that's in
for
the
reasons where book. Students can get the one-on-one interaction with their English teacher like me in a math class. For example, I have a student named Emmanuel, and it was really cool to be able to go into another teacher's math class and help Emmanuel as his English teacher with math, just to see how he works and how he thinks differently in a different subject, and to also show him that even though I'm your English teacher, I still struggle with math too, so as you learn it, I'll learn it with you, and I'll help you get it too, and also just being able to support teachers when they need more help in the classroom, and there's a student who needs more one-on-one instruction, being able to go in as a teacher of that subject and being able to have that one-on-one time with that student or with a group of students. Even so much as helping out another teacher by taking a group of their kids into my classroom during a stack period and doing a more small group instruction based on maybe a rubric or a lesson that a teacher has given me just for that group of students. So they can get that individualized personal relationship with not just one teacher, but with multiple teachers at a time.
So something that I knew that I needed to do, it was part of the work, was figuring out how to create a model classroom. Because I had tried the year before, and it turns out as an instructional coach, when you have a class period, planning for one period is pretty much the same as planning for all the periods. Because especially if you're a model classroom, you're going to want to make sure every single lesson is ready to go. But also, once you have those lessons, there's needs to be an audience to see it. And video recording, you know, you might be able to show people video recordings every couple months at a staff development. But they don't get to practically be involved. And so that's, I think, one of the best parts of the program is the buddy training weeks. So the first 2 weeks of the school year, we're training these students called buddies that are going to be the mentors in classrooms and help with tutoring and everything. Well, in those first 2 weeks, as the buddy person in charge, basically, as the buddy teacher, all the buddies, you know, 35 to 40 students per period come into the model classroom, and I teach lessons and prepare them to be mentors and really leadership lessons in classrooms. Well, the students are in here learning, but also we have all our stack teachers come in throughout the day to learn as well, and they're actually in the seating chart. And so we're actually killing three birds with one stone. First of all, our students are learning to be good buddies and mentors. Secondly, our teachers are learning what it means to be a good buddy and mentor when their students come in to be buddies. But third, and kind of the something we don't discuss, but it really is a model classroom for them to see techniques. And I tried to model as much as I could really, really good instruction to the best of my abilities. And because after 2 weeks the buddies went out into classrooms, we had solved our issue of the model classroom being just something that kept going throughout the year and no one would see it. So the entire school was the audience, and I was able to demonstrate for two weeks how I got my students to progress in my classroom as an instructional teacher. And the cool thing about it is every once in a while we pull our buddies back in for more lessons. So a couple weeks ago, the buddies were back in for a couple days. And the cool thing about it was during my instructional coaching sessions, I had discussed some techniques with some teachers. Well, during that buddy time where all the teachers were coming back through the room, I showed some of the techniques I had only talked about. And so the greatest thing about it is not only do you get to give staff development on things, but you get to practically show it in a real setting and have teachers, all the teachers in a school, participate. And it's really a great practical way to create a school language for what good instruction looks like. There's always something that they can talk about. Oh, well, we saw this lesson. Oh, yeah, maybe I can do this, maybe I can do that. And the model classroom with the buddy trainings combined together has been an incredible experience. Don't get me wrong, it's very difficult at first to teach in front of the entire school, which is really what you end up doing, because the administrators, the counselors, the teachers, support staff come in throughout the entire day. And at first it felt really uncomfortable, but now I really see the power and the benefit and how incredible it is that really one person can change an entire school's worth of instruction in a very practical way. Not just by talking about teaching, but by actually showing it in a real setting and having teachers participate in it as well.
I also love being able to go into the stack classroom. Not only do we have access to the kids that period, but our learning coach, Mr. McAlpine, is a great resource for us.
So, you know, the thing that I really love about coming into the room is, especially when I get to see you in the model classroom, is that me as a teacher, sometimes I struggle, you know, because I'll be like, darn it, like, how do I, like, put, like, a word to define how that is, like, how a classroom gets so out of control so fast, you know? And then I come in and you have, like, a lesson and it's like, brush fires and spot fires, and I'm like, duh, like, how could I have not thought of that? That makes so much sense. Like, it's an analogy, it's a metaphor. If you get spot fires, if you get those out, then you won't have a brush fire. And then you, like, pull out all these, like, tools, like, but if you do have a brush fire, like, this is the way to address it, isn't it? But then the best part is that when we come in here and you're with your kids in the model classroom, you see how amazing these kids are acting because they're, we're, you know, you're living and showing us how to do, you know, all the things you're trying to teach us. And it's just amazing. I mean, like, I know some of these kids and I knew them from last year and they weren't exactly model students, but the, with the way you like treat them, the way you, you gender this, like this feeling of like respect and like, we're all going to like rise above it type of attitude. Like these kids, they act better. They want to do well. They want to raise themselves up, and it's really, really cool. And I mean, half the time when I'm watching you in the model classroom, I'm like, I mean, no offense, but I'm not even listening to what the lesson might be about because I'm frantically writing down all the different stuff I want to do in my classroom. I'm like, holy smokes, I could do that too. I could, you know what I should do? I should have like I should have team captains, kind of like how they do. And then I'm going to have like a team captain meeting, like at the beginning of class, it'll take a minute. And you know, I started doing that. And it's like amazing, like now all the kids, like, you know, the ones that are team captains, they take them more seriously. But I never would have saw that without the like background knowledge of the model classroom where I saw how you were executing that. I mean, it's just, it's great. And then the other thing I really like is that when you have the model classroom going, you actually show how a class can run smoothly, right? With all these different little chunks of activities, you know, like, okay, like, you two are going to read the story, you know, you're going to read the story, but you're going to be drawing while he's reading the story. And then after you're done, you're going to switch, or you're going to describe what you saw, and then you stand up here, and you get over there, and everyone's moving, and people are, like, walking around, and like, and, okay, now what did you guys do when you're walking around, and okay, now do this, and okay, now defend the other person's hypothesis, you know, and it's just like, but there's never, like, a lot of, there's no big lulls, like, oh, I'm just sitting here, and I'm just going to, you know, do nothing important. No, there's always like something going and stuff, and then when I go back to my classroom, I'm like, oh, okay, now I know why I'm breaking apart on this specific, you know, like task or this specific thing. It's because I'm not being explicit enough with the instructions, or I forgot to review procedures, you know. But when I come in here and you're like reviewing procedures or you're doing this stuff, it like it just it's like I see it in action, and it makes it that much more real. And doable, and I love it. I mean, I think that's one of the best parts.
Really wasn't sure what to expect with Buddies. I had seen in a lot of model schools that they had mentorship programs, but they were very small scale, just a few students working with a few other students in a homeroom type structure. And I wanted to go big. I wanted to go global. And so I thought, well, let's do this. Instead of having students go to the mentors, let's bring the mentors to the students, and let's do it every single period, every single day. Let's have one or two buddies in every classroom. And so that's really where we ended up with the buddy trainings, having 35 to 40 students being trained, because after those 2 weeks, they were assigned to classrooms, and that's where they are. So while I'm instructionally coaching and we're doing stackroom stuff, our buddies are already kind of stacked into those classrooms. We have one or two student mentors in every single class, every single period, that are doing some incredible work, incredible work. They're pulling and working with students, they're tutoring, they're being model students, they're helping teachers in a whole bunch of ways I didn't even think was possible. I really feel like our buddies are just miniature teachers in classrooms.
So all my buddies are great, but one in particular is Mr. Rivas. He is in my sixth period, and it is a difficult class because they're very chatty, and some days I have to be a lot more strict with them. And I appreciate my buddy because he's able to read me. He likes to work with me, and so we are able to, it's like he knows, like I can give him a look and he knows, okay, go with that student. Or he knows, okay, you can walk around, or you can pull that student to the side. So it's been really helpful in him being able to identify the students that need help without me actually talking to him. Like sometimes I have to, you know, let him know, okay, today we're doing this, wherever you see that you need to go, you should do that. And so I appreciate that he takes the initiative and he's always willing to help any student.
They're starting to pull small groups, which helps me out a lot because there's one of me and 28 kids sometimes. So my buddies have gotten really good at pulling groups, getting started, helping out the kids that need help, not just telling them answers. I see what we learned in Mr. McAlpine's tutoring process. They are utilizing it. So kudos to them, and it helps out a lot. And I know the kids respond very well.
I think the buddy program is beneficial, not only just for like the teachers, the fact that they are here to help support us, but they also support the students in a way that I can't do sometimes. Because as a teacher, if I have a student who may not understand it, I can give tons and tons of examples, but that student just doesn't get it from me. But then I literally could have one of my buddies who's a student in another period, who's already taken that class, go over and say the same example that I gave, just say it in a different way, and that kid can understand it or get it. Or even just having my students, my buddies who are taking my class already, just have them in another classroom during another period, and they already know my lesson. They've already been through it. They've already mastered that lesson, and so they can help the other students. They can be a co-teacher for me in the classroom. For example, one time there was a student who raised their hand and I didn't see him. I had one of my students, Lynette, go over to him because she'd already taken the class. She told him exactly what he needed to do without me having to get up and say anything. And she was able to make that communication with me, look at me and see that I needed the help, and she was able to provide the help.
I have phenomenal buddies in my fourth and fifth period classes. Particularly my fifth period, I have Luis, and he just jumps in and helps all of my students. He participates in the lesson. He is a phenomenal model student. And then when the kids get stuck, he is right there helping them out, and we do a lot of hands-on projects because that's my science class, and he has been phenomenal with helping the kids figure out what they're supposed to do.
They were so great, you know, Ms. Palacio and Ms. Tarula. Just, I mean, amazing, you know, and I have a smaller caseload because I work with a special ed population, and it was just, like, I couldn't believe it. It was like having two assistants in my room that had been, you know, had gone to school to learn how to be assistants. But they're eighth graders, and they're not, the only special training they got was in your model classroom. So I'm like, these kids are as valuable each as an assistant, like, that I used to have, like, in the classroom. And it's like, I can't believe it. And then they come up to me, and they're like, hey, Mr. Cisneros, like, we had these ideas. We thought maybe we could, like, do some activities for Halloween. Like, we'd like to do, like, a Day of the Dead thing, and maybe we can, like, make sugar candy and like paint the skulls and then do like a story and then have them act it out. And this is the kids, regular kids, eighth graders that are coming to me, giving me ideas, and they're like, but we can come early, no problem. We'll come early and help you do. And I'm like, oh my goodness. I'm like, I mean, and I remember when it happened, I was choked up, you know, because I thought, this is amazing. Like, these are eighth grade students that if they wouldn't have had the model classroom, you know, and the buddy program, they probably just would have gone along and been great students. But now they're contributing, they're taking ownership, they're leading, they're mentoring. I mean, it's great. So I love my buddies.
And it also gives me extra time with her. So if she's in buddy class and I give her the option to do her work in that she would do in the sixth period when she has me, but then she's such a greater help with her sixth period. So if she's doing it with third period or whatever class I have her in as a buddy, then she can help and her regular
Frida,
class.
Was a student who people actually warned me and said her behavior may not be good, but actually she's really blossomed as a buddy beyond any of the other buddies that I have. She was able to walk around yesterday and help kids with their writing and give them real suggestions about how to make their stories better. And she was making the rounds better than I could. I get stuck and I try to help a kid who's got a lot of trouble, but she was very efficient and got around to everybody, and people seem to be helped by her. So.
David Sanchez, he's been doing a really good job working with one of my kids that I'm barely finding out he's autistic. He's been kind of like a big brother almost, like sit next to him and help him do, you know, like, okay, dude, now you need to write this, and kind of keeping him on track and, you know, get him like an order. You know, I really appreciate David.
My daughter has multiple disabilities, and so she is in she's in preschool now, and she's in a deaf and hard of hearing class. And at other schools, they do have buddies that go into rooms where students that have special needs. And this was a huge thing for me, that we selected the right buddies to go into our special needs classrooms, and I really think we did. I go in and I watch them, and our students with special needs, they have friends. They are truly friends to them. It's a very personal matter for me to be able to see them interacting and know that this is the school I want my daughter to be at, where she's not isolated and alone. So I knew we needed a way to get PLC time, but I had been a part of the model of students coming in late to school, and I knew there was just something that I didn't like about it. I really just thought that that time could be harnessed for something else. And so the idea of a club time, or what we call acceleration time, came about. And it was basically, how do we have students on campus doing something really valuable, but also give our teachers some extra time for professional learning community work, which is essential. And so what we did was we took our PLC groups and we paired them up so that when one group's running the club 1 week, the other one will be a PLC time, and then they switch every week. And it freed up a lot of time, but at the same time, our clubs have taken off. It is an absolute unbelievable success that I never even could have thought of, that our students have more of an ownership over school now. They love Thursday club time. They love it. It's a reason to come to school. And to be honest, I love it. I go around when I'm not with PLCs and I go into clubs, and it's amazing. There are students that are cooking food and, hey, come taste this, Mr. Mac. And there's students that are planning events, and NJHS gets extra time, and Future Cities is making some incredible leaps with SimCity, and there's a college futures club, and I think one called Leaving Las Vegas, where they talk about traveling and things, and there's book clubs where kids are really interested in reading books they actually want to read. It is just incredible how club time has changed the environment of our school.
Today in the bistro, we made tostada bites, and we made chicken salad with waffles, and I had kids doing smoothies, and they love kind of getting outside the box. We also had white pizza, and somebody, when I told him it was white pizza and they said no sauce, turned their nose up, but she found out that she loved the white pizza with just a little bit of mayonnaise, a little bit of garlic, a little bit of onion, throw in some cheese, do it in the broiler. They're learning how to read recipes. They're learning how to make their own additions or subtractions if something they don't like. They love to walk around and share their food with their teachers and their friends. We have 37 kids now, 120 signed up. They love to be here. I hear time and time again, I just love Thursdays. Can we have Thursday all the time? Can every day be a Thursday? Because they just love coming in and experimenting with food and eating and trying new things that maybe they would have never tried before, and then taking those recipes home and cooking for their family.
I enjoy the club time. It's like a relaxing educational part of the day. So even though instruction's happening and the kids are still present and have to be accounted for their attendance, it's still nice to know that you could put a different flair on the education. So it's not book work, or maybe for some clubs it is, but mine is best self, so it's more of a meditation, self-confidence booster. So I really enjoy that hour out of the day when we get to do it, when we're not alternating with our...
creating acceleration time. Acceleration time is also a benefit, because now beyond schoolwork at school, kids get to do something that they enjoy, which keeps their energy up for school. So by Thursday, they know their acceleration time's coming around, and they get to do something fun that's somewhat school related, and they get to talk to their teachers about it. So every Thursday, I hear about the movie that the movie club is talking about. I hear about the facts that are facts, or the things that aren't fact, the fact or fiction club. My group is NJHS, the National Junior Honor Society. We spend that time planning how to help
time,
others.
The theme is Future Cities, and it seems like I have almost 98%, 100% buy-in from the students that are enrolled in that club with me. We are working on a project that really involves model making, researching with the internet and the computer, writing, as well as a computer program called SimCity. And by having those four components together, it really engages the students and they participate in the most amazing ways. I really enjoy my club time. It almost feels like a retreat from the day, and for the students, the comments especially today were they wish they could have club time every single day. They wish they could have club time all day. So it's definitely been worthwhile with my students. I just got two new students in who are autistic, and they were thrilled. They seemed to just fit right in with the group, and we just really enjoy learning about cities, because our theme is on cities. We're learning about how to, all the parts that are involved in creating a successful city on the computer, and then that is kind of rolling into good research, because our challenge is to try to answer a question about growing plants and proteins in a city to help a city survive for the future. And the kids are very, very excited about the challenge. They're excited about making the models. They're excited about the hands-on aspects. They're excited about the computer integration to it. So it's been sort of a win-win this whole time.
Professional learning community work is the work that we need to do to improve our school. I've known that from the very beginning. At Mojave High School, our biology PLC started our first year as what Mike Maddox calls a one team. We were, whether it was fighting, we couldn't figure out anything. That team time was just completely wasted. But when I stepped up as leader of the PLC team, I started to think about, okay, how can we really make this work? Let's make this work for kids. Let's make this time valuable. And in 3 years, we went from a one team to a 10 team, which is basically we are truly intercollaboratively working for our students with common assessments, data analysis, you know, instructional methods, sharing, helping each other out to make sure all students learn. And as a result, that model spread and allowed me to become a PLC coach. And the science department is really where PLC took off the most. And in 3 years, the proficiency rate for science students, and I truly believe because of the professional learning community work, because that's the department where it took off the most, went from 22% up to 84%. Over 60% growth in proficiency because of our PLC work. One of the most incredible things about the STAC teams is two periods of time where teachers don't have students. One of them lines up with their PLC and one of them doesn't. And so what we can do is what's called a flip. So we take our lined up PLC time, we take our stack time, and we flip it. That allows us to give teachers still their personal preps and not take that time, but now we have time for PLC work. Well, we're not taking a personal prep to do it, we're not taking before school, after school, we're not getting subs. We actually add up the amount of time that we give our teachers to do professional learning community work when we flip the schedule. It comes out to 300 minutes that week. And that's more time than any other school in the entire nation has been able to free up for professional learning community work. And that was, to be honest, unexpected. It was something we figured out through the process of making things work. And our teachers now are legitimately taking that time to debate and to create their essential curriculum and common formative assessments that we did at Mojave, and it took us years to get there. But the great thing is, as a professional learning community coach, because the schedule's flipped, every period, only two PLC teams are meeting. So I spend half the period with one team, half with another, and I get to coach those teams away from some of the obstacles that we ran into at Mojave. And so our PLC teams are really doing the right work right up front, because throughout that whole day, I coach and meet with every single PLC team, and I'm able to, you know, kind of be in the background, but guide them towards the correct and the right work that's going to lead them to student success. And it's just been absolutely incredible.
What number? 22. So that would be six, would be language?
6.3.
What feeling did I get when my principal came in and cussed me out in front of my students? The principal's words were,
well, angry. That's higher level.
That might get into a whole other deal.
That could be the exceeding, yeah.
That's my way of explaining tone versus mood. The mood is how the whole audience felt when they saw that happen to the teacher, you know? Okay. So I wonder.
So just, we can call them tone slash mood words, right?
Yeah, yeah, that's a good way to say it. So how many should an emergent student
Well, and we have some of these examples too, like text. How does the author create the tone? What is the main way of the author creates a personal tone?
Description of setting, description of
third person,
plot twist. That is truly creative.
Omniscient, the mood.
Yeah. So,
could you then
that would be more advanced.
But I would actually put in parentheses what you mean by effects,
right? You have to be specific.
And just reading effects.
Creates your own effect. I'm not just going to leave it at that. I was going to change
every character.
But that's
no,
that's
right. Just put in parentheses what you just explained.
I can see everything.
Using tone words.
I'm limited just to my main character.
And mood, atmosphere, creating a...
Since we started our PLC time, I feel like our vision for where our students need to be is much more clear, which makes our planning on the day-to-day basis very concise, and it makes it more meaningful because we have in our minds where we want students to be, what they need to be thinking about, and then we can also take into consideration the other grade levels. The planning itself has brought our team together. Two of us had worked together previously, but the third person joined late this year. And since that person has joined late, we thought it would be a little rough getting started and getting those plans together, getting on the same page. But actually, our PLC work time, our PLC goals, and really thinking about our students' needs has brought us together and allowed us to figure out how to communicate very effectively and make sure that we're constantly thinking about what our classrooms, what our students need, what we need to be achieving during the year, rather than how do we feel about each other or do we like this activity that so-and-so planned. I really think that the PLC work is what's going to make the difference between our students succeeding in future math classes versus maybe just having a successful year because they appreciate their teacher or they appreciate the structures of that classroom. So it's going to have a longer impact than just what I can do this year. I feel like I really can make a difference in their trajectory.
Beginning of a journey that it started in Arizona with a PLC conference, and it really lit a fire under me to research and figure out, you know, what's the next step, what needs to happen. And I thought initially that next step was for Mojave High School, but it turned out that was actually a next step, I believe, for PLC and RTI work, in that I studied every single model school as closely as I could, and I had the time to do that. And it turned out everyone's doing the right work. I just don't necessarily think that they're freeing up the time that it takes to do that work. And because of the stacked period and the PLC period, because of those times we freed up for teachers, we can actually do the right work. If we're instructionally coaching, we can spend plenty of time with videotapes and discussions. We have that time. If we're doing PLC work, we have so much time during the week, more than any other school. And so we can make that work. Because of the model classroom, we have buddies in every single classroom as mentors. You know, we had the time to make that
Everybody
work.
Everybody wants teachers to observe each other. You know, they want that sort of interaction. They want open doors. What we had to do was we simply made the time so that it could work. And as a result, we have thousands of hours of teachers in each other's classrooms learning in a practical way but not just learning, supporting each other.
I have been teaching at Bailey since a year after it opened. I've seen many administrations change, tons of people change. A lot of people tried a lot of things to make this a better place. This year with the buddies and the stack time team, things are going incredibly better. We have finally found a way to legitimize the smart kids, meaning everyone wants to be them. Everyone wants to be a buddy this year. They want to join NJHS when that used to be taboo. It seems like it was accomplished by just rearranging the schedule. There's been a tremendous change in Bailey this year.
Fire drill. I was on stack during sixth period when the fire drill happened. And so just kind of wandering around school, I heard that it was gonna happen. So I thought I should go to Miss Kozlowski's room because she has a child in a wheelchair. So I just thought that that would be a good place for me to stack during the fire drill because I didn't know where he was gonna go or what the situation was gonna be. So I went over to her classroom, and then while the fire drill was happening, I was able to take that student in the wheelchair who also has autism with a student in that class who's one of my science students who's a buddy in Miss Rakefeld's class. So Miss Kozlowski knew that, and she paired him with him so that they could walk together during the fire drill and he wouldn't get upset. And then I went with them as well, being an additional teacher in the room. And I just decided as we were talking, because you know the fire drills are crazy and everybody's wandering, and so I was able to talk to him, and I was wearing my keys around my neck like this, and he saw this key, and so I showed him that you can pop it out like this, and he thought it was really cool. And so we started talking about cars, and he was asking me about the fire truck, and it was a conversation that in that class he couldn't have ever had, but because we were outside and we were walking and we were able to connect with one another, we talked about cars. And so I just went back with them after the fire drill and kind of hung out in that classroom because we were having a good conversation. And he told me that he hates English, which I don't know if he hates English. I think it was just kind of he hates being in an environment or hates being in the class or whatever. And so we were talking and I said, well, hey, can you write a paragraph about a car? And then Mr. Swindell, who's the co-teacher in that class, was helping, and he ended up writing an entire paragraph about, you know, the cars that he likes and what type of car he wants and how he wants to learn how to drive a car in the future and all these things. And that moment, I guess, for me is what made me realize like why I'm in stack and why I enjoy it so much, because there's already two teachers in that room, but it's a 38, 39 person co-teach class. It's a difficult class to be in. And then on top of it, having a student with autism in a wheelchair, he doesn't have a lot of mobility in the classroom. And he does pull a lot of attention, and he needs that one-on-one to get him working, to get him doing what he needs to do so that he can continue to grow as a student. And I think while I was in that class, another one of my students, because this is an eighth grade classroom, was the buddy. And you could tell that she wanted to help him, and she's such a good student, but she didn't know how to start a conversation with him, or when he would say things like, I don't like this person, or I don't like this. Like, as teachers, we know to not take offense, but as an eighth grader, you're like, does he really not like me? Am I causing him problems? And so she was able to come and work with me and him. And so it's nice to know that even though I can't be back in that classroom every single day with him, I helped a buddy learn how to work with a student that maybe she was nervous about being around or didn't know what to do. And so, you know, every time I kind of poke back in during stack and just say hi and what are you writing about today and all those things, and he's continually been writing paragraphs the last like couple of days since I left. And we made an agreement that if he writes 10 paragraphs, we'll play Chinese checkers because it's his favorite board game. So it's cool to actually be able to get that one-on-one time with students, and not just me with that student who I don't even have, but I was able to build better relationships with two students that are in my science classes by seeing their leadership and being able to tell them that I appreciate their leadership and appreciate who they are as people because they did such a great job with him and with that classroom. So just wanted to share.
This being my fourth year, I mean, the old system was new to me coming from high school. This is just a change, but I think it's a good change. I love my hallway. I love my team. I mean, I've always loved my team, but I just feel like there's hope, I guess, is the biggest thing.